Sati is the important thing. You know it. And it's a good training to know. Also to know what needs to be done. You come there in the room, you see, you look before you do something, but you know, you think you don't have the time, huh?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, but the wrong things come from thinking. Yeah? I mean, the Upatthaks of Lungta, observe what Lungta was doing, you know, when he came back to his kuti. They observed it through a little hole, yeah? And then they saw, yeah, what he's doing. Yeah? So that they knew it, yeah? They get it right. We need also a good memory. Yeah? Lumpu Li has done it. Lumpu Man was tough. Yeah? If you want to know, if you want to understand why we are in the situation that we are in, then the only thing we have to do is look into the heart. It's all explained there. The problem is when we look in our heart, all what we see is thoughts and memories. Yeah? So we have to chuck them out, you know, to see at the bottom of the heart. And that is the practice. Huh? The practice to chuck out thoughts and memories. Yeah? To get down to the heart. Yeah? To get down, you know, to our, yeah, whatever you want to call it, you know, you can call it citta or true identity or whatever. And Buddhism gives us the framework for doing it. Yeah? What do we need to know about Buddhism? Yeah? Buddhism is a religion in the true sense, yeah? I mean, religion comes from the Latin word religare, that means pointing back to oneself. So it's the only true religion, yeah? When we look at Christianity, it points to a God, yeah? Who rules us, you know, who decides everything for us, in what situation we are, where we are born, how long we live, and so on, what kind of faith, yeah? But Buddhism doesn't have somebody who is responsible for all beings, and you know, it has, you know, it tells us we are responsible for our own life. Yeah. So, if we want to understand the basics of Buddhism, is the Four Noble Truths, yeah, and the three characteristics: anicca, anatta, dukkha. Yeah? And of course, the most important thing is karma. Yeah? So, what are the Four Noble Truths? Yeah? The first noble truth is that of dukkha. There's dukkha. What is dukkha? It means dissatisfaction, dis-ease, unease, yeah? Discomfort, yeah? Pain and suffering, mental pain, physical pain, yeah? Mental suffering, physical suffering. Yeah? That's all dukkha. It's a container that contains all this irritation, yeah? that we don't like. Where is dukkha coming from? That's the second noble truth, the origin of dukkha. It's from our desire, wanting to be, not wanting to be, wanting to have, not wanting to have. We can't just stay, we can't just stay in this world without changing anything. And we know it, we lived long enough in this world, we need to change things, And I very clearly see it with my upataks, they need to change everything, I don't want to change anything, I mean, it's there in the perfect place, unless I reorganize. Being happy with the way things are, that wouldn't cause any dukkha, but we cannot be happy. We want this, we want that, that doesn't come, we are disappointed, or that what we have is leaving us, then we are disappointed, or saddened, or whatever. So that is the origin of dukkha, our desire, wanting to change, wanting to be somebody that we are not, or wanting to become something, or wanting not to become something. Meeting with somebody, that we don't want to meet, is dukkha. Not getting what one wants is dukkha. So that is the origin of dukkha. The third noble truth is there is an end of dukkha. Just a happy statement for people who seek to the end of dukkha. And the fourth noble truth is the path that leads to the end of dukkha. And it's comprised of three columns. Sila, Samadhi, Panya. What is Sila? Sila are the five precepts. The first precept, not to take what is not given. Actually, it's the second. The first is not to harm any living being. And living being is also animal. Not to take what is given. What is not given is the second precept. It's not only stealing. And the third precept is no sexual misconduct. Being faithful in one's relationship or marriage. And not using somebody because of one's position for his sexual pleasure. So, what is that? We know it all, I mean, we heard it, People used to get upset, when a chef, had sex with his secretary, or a professor had a sex with one of his students. I mean, 100 years ago, it was even punishable by law. Even, not being faithful in one's marriage was punishable by law. And now, it's a free ride, people think. And we still hear it, it still happens a lot, And we look away when these things happen. It has become number one sin in the whole world, sexual misconduct. And the fourth precept is not to lie, not to mislead somebody, and not to criticize somebody, that's also wrong speech, not to criticize somebody, for us to feel good, to put people down. And the fifth precept is no alcohol and drugs, everything that makes us unmindful. These are the five precepts. They are there for our protection. What do they protect us from? Protect us from going down to hell. Because breaking one of these precepts, will lead us to hell. No matter how long. And depending on the gravity. It's just like the laws of our country. I mean, if we steal, we need to go to the prison if they catch us. If you murder somebody, or kill somebody, you also go to prison. But these laws are laws for every country and for every realm of existence. There are 33 realms of existence. We are on the fifth level. Human beings are on the fifth level. Above us, are the devas that live in the world. The Rukha devas or how do we call them? The deities, the forest deities, And then there are the heavenly realms. What is it? 24 of them. Different realms in heaven. And then below us is the animal realm that we can see. And then comes the ghost realm that some of us can see. And the demon realm, and then the hell realm. And also in the hell realm, it's not just one big hell. You know, there are 25 different realms within the hell. Yeah, depending on our going against the five precepts, you know, we will end up in this or in that hell. So it is our choice. Yeah, it is our choice where we go. It's our choice what we do. Yeah? And that's why I call them protection. They protect us from falling down. Yeah? Nobody wants to go into these realms. Yeah? Nobody wants to become an animal, yeah? Or be treated like an animal. Yeah? Nobody wants to be born as a ghost. Yeah? Nobody wants to go to hell. Yeah? We all want to be at least human beings. Yeah? And some of us want to be a heavenly being. There are ways, yeah? Just like, you know, just like when we are at the train station, you know, there are different there are different gates, you know, different trains that lead in different directions, and we need different tickets for that. Yeah, and we need and the amount of money that we need is also different. So in order, you know, to come back as a human being, we have to keep the five precepts. Yeah? If we want to get up into the higher realms, yeah, the heavenly realms, then we need to develop three virtues. Yeah? The virtue of generosity, yeah? Being generous, yeah? Giving things. Yeah? It's also necessary for us to go on the path, yeah? Being generous with material things, yeah? It is the first step, you know, in letting go, you know, of our attachment to material things and letting go of our attachment to things that are much more closer to us, that is our ideas and our thoughts, yeah? So generosity is something, yeah? It's one of the virtues, yeah? Respect is another virtue. Yeah? Respecting one's parents, respecting the teachers that one had in school, huh? Respecting every being, yeah? Because every being has a right, you know, it is a being, yeah? No matter what, yeah? No matter what it does, yeah? We can respect it as a being. Is it good? You know, I mean, we only respect people that are according to our views, that are good people. No, we have to respect every person. A person that comes as a human being has at least kept the five precepts. So, I mean, that is quite good, yeah, for a certain amount of time. Maybe it took him hundreds or thousands of lives, you know, to become a human being again, yeah? But anyway, yeah, what he does now with his life, you know, that's his problem, yeah? But at least they have kept the five precepts, so they can come back as a human being, yeah? So we can respect human beings, animals just the same way, yeah? Other beings, yeah? But respecting one's parents is of utmost importance, yeah? Because they looked after us for so many years, yeah? They fed us, you know? I mean, they clothed us, yeah? They put us through school, yeah? And sometimes, you know, through university. How can we not have respect for them? Also the teachers trying to teach us something that we can live in this society. And it's not only the teacher, the worldly teachers, it's also the the spiritual teachers. Respect is one thing that we need most, yeah. Also on the path, yeah. We need to be able to respect the Lord Buddha and his teaching. We cannot just say, you know, I mean, what the Lord Buddha said, yeah, that's just nice, you know, because I like it, and that's not so nice because I don't like it. Yeah? Cannot be selective. And the last virtue is gratitude, being grateful for what is given to us, yeah? Even if you don't like it, yeah? Lots of things are given to us. Yeah? Our life is given to us, you know, by our parents, yeah? The things that we need, you know, to develop this body are given to us, yeah? So how can we not be grateful? How can we constantly only demand that this is given to us or that is given to us? And in a kind of practice, a lot of things will be given to us. Yeah? Happiness, joy, yeah? And insight. Yeah? How can we not be grateful for these things? Yeah? These are the three virtues, and they are also for monks who look for the way out, you know, are very important. Yeah? We have to develop, or we have had to develop them in order to be able to be here and become monks. So that is the first column, you know, sila. Yeah? And the second column is samadhi. Yeah? Samadhi is very important. We need to be able to concentrate on one subject. And that's what we learn when we concentrate on the breath at the tip of the nose, being aware of the breath going in or being aware of the breath going out. And when there's a thought, you know, when we notice we are unaware of the breath, then we return the tip of the nose. So the point of the focus is the tip of the nose. When we mentally repeat the word Buddha, then the point of focus is the Buddha. Yeah? So whenever there's no Buddha, you know, we bring it back. And whenever there's a thought, we bring it back. Yeah? And we bring it back, and we bring it back. Yeah? When there's a memory or when there's a vision, we always bring it back to the Buddha. Yeah? Or bring it back to the tip of the nose, yeah? In order to reach concentration. Of course, we have to be interested into the subject, yeah, that we are concentrating on. We have to be interested in the variety of the Buddha. Not every Buddha is the same. The Buddha changes. Yeah? Sometimes it's slow, sometimes it's fast, sometimes it's deep, sometimes it's shallow. Yeah? So we have to be interested. Yeah? The more we are interested, the easier the practice goes, yeah? And the faster we get concentrated. Being 100% interested is 100% concentration and we are gone. Not being interested or half interested, you know, gives a half-hearted result. Yeah? So samadhi is, you know, the practice of samadhi or the practice of samatha, that means calm meditation, yeah? Has two fruits. Yeah? It has the fruit of upachara samadhi, where our thoughts and memories are gone and we are just living in the present moment. Yeah? Where things are just happening, where there is nobody who takes hold of this experience and says, ah, that's great, or that's not so great, or why is this thought coming in, why is that coming in? There is no such entity like that anymore. So we are free, we are actually safe, yeah? We feel like in a safe house, nothing can touch us. Yeah? The moment we come out, you know, everything is the same. All the things, you know, be it sound or be it, you know, vision, you know, touch us, yeah? Affect us, yeah? Make us think or make us memorize, yeah? Make us like or make us dislike. The second stage, you know, of samadhi is, you know, absolute concentration or deep samadhi, where everything disappears, where we see, you know, where we suddenly realize that all this, yeah? All this, what we see now, yeah, all our life is just a virtual reality. Yeah? Because all these things are gone, the whole universe collapses. Yeah? When the body is gone, yeah, the senses are gone, everything is gone. And the only thing that remains is our true identity. Yeah? And this true identity, you can call it clear knowing, yeah? Or clear knowingness. Huh? But this knowingness doesn't know of any objects. It's just pure knowingness. As long as we train our samadhi, I mean, yeah, there's a knower that knows of the breath, or there's a knower that knows of the Buddha. Yeah? That's it. And when these two, subject and object, merge into one thing, what can we say about this world? All this world must collapse, you know, subject and object merge into one thing. It must collapse, yeah? It's impossible, yeah? To exist. That's also called the conventional reality where subject and object exist, yeah? When the subject and object merge, everything disappears, yeah? And we feel completely at ease, yeah? We feel completely free, yeah? And when we come out, I mean, we feel like we come back in the world war of the senses. Yeah? You're just constantly bombarded with senses, with this thing and with that thing. Yeah. And all what we need to do is concentrate on the same point. I mean, it's so easy. Said, yet so difficult done. Because we don't have enough interest. We can't, you know. We need to think this thought, you know, this is important. Or, yeah, or maybe at a later stage, you know, this insight, this seemingly insight, that's not a real insight, arises and we are taken by it. Yeah? And that distracts us and then we get into thinking and then we forget our practice. So all what is necessary is to keep our attention, yeah, on the Buddha or on the tip of the nose. Yeah? And when we do the breath meditation, we will notice, you know, just the same thing with the Buddha, but with the breath meditation we will notice that at a certain level of concentration, the concentration will split into two things. It will split into the point of concentration and the knowing about the point. And that's exactly what we are after. We are after this knowingness, or what is called also awareness or sati. We're after this. That's what we want to train. We cannot train sati directly. Yeah? That's why we use concentration. Yeah? And knowingness about the object that we concentrate on. Yeah? So we need to ask ourselves, is the Buddha slow? Is the Buddha fast? Is it deep? Is it shallow? Yeah? We have to know it. Yeah? And that's what fosters, you know, that was fostered the sati. It's the same with the breath. Is the breath deep? Is it shallow? Is it fast, is it long? Is the in-breath longer or the out-breath longer, or and so on and so on? Every moment of the breath or every moment of the Buddha we have to focus on, be interested in it, how it is at this very moment. Yeah? And that can be so absorbing that we can completely get absorbed. Yeah? And when we are absorbed, then we are most of the time then we are in upachara samadhi. And then we feel safe. There is no worries, there is no future and there is no past. How can we worry about anything? How can we feel alone if there's nothing, you know? There's no loneliness, there's no fear, there's complete freedom. Yeah? Just this little thing, yeah? Just this little practice, you know, gives us the freedom, yeah? Or gives us a safe house where we can, anywhere, yeah? Anywhere in the world, you know, be it in the bus station or be it on the airport, you know, we can retract ourselves, yeah? But we are so brought up, you know, to look outward, yeah, that it is difficult for us to, you know, to look inside. Yeah? Inside, the problems can be solved. Or actually, there doesn't exist any problems. Yeah? Problems are only created by the mind. Yeah? But this is not enough, you know. I mean, if you want to really get rid of dukkha or reach at the stage of the end of dukkha, I mean, we have to do investigation. Yeah? That is the third column, yeah, of the path that leads to the end of dukkha. Yeah? Investigation. Yeah? What do we investigate? Investigate the things that we believe we are. What do we believe we are? First and foremost is the body. Of course we believe we are the body. We look in the mirror and we see us. Yeah? How can we not believe that we are this body? The second is feeling. Yeah? We are so attached to these feelings and we believe it's our feelings. Yeah? If you have a sad feeling, try to change it to a happy one. Can you do it? So how can you tell yourself, you know, it's my feeling? The feeling just came up, just like a cloud comes up, you know. We have to wait until it's over. Yeah? So, there are five groups that make us. Yeah? They are called the five khandhas, or the five groups. That is the body, that's feeling. Feeling is split it up in two groups. It's bodily feeling and mental feeling. Yeah? There are thoughts, yeah? Short form of thoughts. And there's memory and association. What is association? I mean, if you see a door, then we associate that's a door. When we see a tree, then we associate that's a tree. And all the finer things, that's all come from memory. How to open a door comes from memory, and so on, and so on. So memory and thought are a big part, play a big part in our life. And the last thing is consciousness. What is consciousness? We believe we are conscious. All these things that we believe we are, that we are, we have to investigate and see its true nature. And the first thing that we have to investigate is this body, because we are so attached to this body. We are born in this body, we die in this body, so we believe we are this body. So investigation leads to the end of dukkha. So if we understand the true nature and are not too attached to these five groups, then we can go into nibbana, into absolutely freedom. The three characteristics that I mentioned before are anicca, anatta, dukkha. Anicca is impermanent. Whatever arises must cease. We are born, we die. A flower blossoms, you know, it dies. A tree, you know, grows until it dies. Everything arises and ceases. Even our world. It will just disappear. Just like the solar system will disappear. And other stars are created. So things appear and disappear. That is the nature of this universe or this conventional reality. We know in the West, we know the four seasons. There's winter, there's spring, summer, and there's autumn. It constantly changes. In the summer, each summer is different from the summer before. Things are changing, constantly changing. Our breath is changing, the Buddha is changing, the weather is changing, feelings are changing. So, one of these characteristics, of this universe is anicca, impermanent. All things are impermanent. The second thing is, all these things are not me. Whatever I can observe is not me, it's not myself, it doesn't belong to me. That's what the Lord Buddha teaches. Anatta, it's a principle of anatta. That's not me, that's not myself, it doesn't belong to me. And the third one is dukkha. And then we start with the first noble truth, the truth of dukkha. It is not satisfying because things are changing and so it's not satisfactory. We love things that last. But we see, nothing lasts in this world. So we use this principle in the investigation, in order to distance ourselves. So like I just said, about the feelings. If there is a sad feeling, we cannot change it into a nice feeling. If I have a black shirt on and I don't like the black shirt that I have on and I want to change it into a white shirt, I look in my wardrobe and change it to a white shirt. If I don't have it, I buy it. But with feelings, we can't do that. Because they are not us. They don't belong to us. It's the same with thoughts. Everybody who meditates notice, that when he decides, for the next hour I'm staying with Buddha or I'm staying with breath, I'm not interested in any thought, the thoughts come in. They come on their own. We didn't invite them. 99% of the thoughts we'd never invite. And if you want to think about something, sometimes it doesn't even pop up. So how can we call it our thoughts, my thought? The same with memory. The memories come in, No matter what, we don't invite them. And especially if we want to meditate, we don't invite them to come in. So they come in. How can we call this me, mine, myself? It's a memory, that's it. And there's a little trick that you can use. Whenever there's a feeling coming up, sadness, don't say, I'm sad. So just say, there is sadness. And then we can observe something, we have subject and object. The moment you say, I'm sadness, you mix it all up together and you cannot investigate it. It's the same with the body, I'm this body. Are you the body when it was young? Are you the body when you're old? Are you the body when you're born? Yeah. How does it's different? Yeah? In which body are you? Yeah? Which thought? You know, I mean, what is the red line in your life? Think about it. Is there a red line? Yeah? The thoughts you know you had 20 years ago, I mean, are very different from the thoughts you had 10 years ago, and are very different from the thoughts you have now. So how can you say, I mean, it's my thought? Thoughts are changing, yeah. Body is changing. All these things are changing. So what is it? You know, when you want to really describe yourself, what is you? Yeah? So use this principle of anatta, or you can use the principle of anicca if you like it more. Yeah, I mean, all these things are impermanent. You know, if a sad feeling comes, we just wait, yeah, until it disappears. Yeah? And the good thing, you know, and when we train concentration, or actually what we do is replace, yeah? We replace the thought that comes in with the thought of Buddha, yeah? Or we replace a thought, I mean, we do that all our life. Or we replace, you know, a thought with the concentration of going back with the awareness on our tip of the nose. It's not that we don't know how to do these things. We do it all our life long. Yeah? When you go through the streets of Paris, you know, and you see a heap of shit, you know, you don't look at it, you know, I mean, you look away. You don't want to see. That's replacing reality with something else. Yeah? It's replacing your attention on one thing with replacing attention on another thing. So it is not suppressing. Yeah? It's just replacing, you know. We can put our attention on anything that we like. Yeah? And we are so used to, and we trained ourselves so much, yeah? We don't like to see, you know, beggars, we don't like to see bad people, you know, we always look away. Yeah? And we don't like to see our own faults, that's why we always look away. Yeah? So we use this ability that we have trained so much, you know, to use it for our own benefits. Yeah? So replacing any kind of thoughts, any kind of memories with the word Buddha or with the attention on the breath. Yeah? It's nothing new, it's not suppressing. Yeah? Suppressing is if we don't, yeah, if a thought comes up and we don't like this thought and we really are getting angry, why is this stupid thought coming up? Then, yeah, and we don't want to have this thought, then it is suppressing. But just replacing our attention, you know, when a thought comes up with the word of Buddha, you know, it's not suppressing. It's just that what we normally do in our life. So investigating the body, yeah? That is the first, you know, first stage of investigation. Yeah? I mean, actually we start, you know, when we do sitting meditation, then the first thing that we do is investigating feelings, painful feelings, bodily feelings. Yeah? Because after 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours of sitting, you know, painful feelings come up. Then we ask ourselves, what is pain? Yeah? That is our sharpening stone for actually then later on doing the investigation of the body. What is pain? Where is the pain? Yeah? Is it like a spook? Yeah? I mean, the moment I get up from my meditation, the pain is gone. How can that be pain? Yeah? If you're really in pain, I mean, Don Richard knows it, you know, I mean, his hand, you know, is cut, you know, the pain, no matter if he lies down or if he gets up or if he sits, you know, there's pain. Yeah? So why is this pain only coming when we sit in meditation? And it seems to be bodily pain. So that's why we need to investigate. What is pain? Yeah? How does it feel like? Is it point-wise? Is it area-wise? Is it changing? Is it in the skin? Is it in the bones? Is it in the flesh? Is it in the tendon? Yeah? And we shouldn't, you know, we shouldn't fall for the tricks of the kilesas, you know, that tells us, oh yeah, you sit too long and that's why there's pain. Hmm? When you sit in the airplane for 11 hours, there's not much pain. No? Because you distract yourself. Yeah? You don't do Buddha. Yeah? I mean, if you sit in the airplane and do Buddha, 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 you know, I mean, you will be in pain just as much as you are here in pain. So what is pain? Yeah? So we concentrate on the pain. I mean, that's the only exception that we are allowed to do when we do samatha, when we do calm meditation. Yeah? When there is so much pain that we cannot concentrate on the Buddha or on the breath, then we are allowed to investigate what is pain. And when you see, when you really question what is pain, yeah, first of all, of course, you have to accept there is pain. Yeah? Accept the feeling of pain, yeah? Look at it, yeah? Accept it with the whole body, and then go with your concentration to the point of pain. And then start to ask the right question. What is pain? Yeah? Where is it? Yeah? Point-wise, area-wise, is it changing? Yeah? And just the moment, you know, when you go to come close to the truth, it changes. I mean, before it was in the left knee, then it changes to the right knee. Yeah? And then you go to the right knee and then do the same thing. And then you go to the back and wherever it jumps to. Yeah? Then you see, I mean, it's a magic trick. Yeah? It's not pain itself. Yeah? There's no pain. And sometimes in the beginning stages of our pain investigation, pain just, you know, the moment you concentrate on it, it just disappears. Huh? That's interesting. So we follow it up and see where it's coming from. Once we understand where it's coming from, we are not afraid of pain anymore. It's just a feeling, just like any kind of feeling. Just like, yeah, I mean, being sleepy and being tired, yeah, being being hungry, being thirsty, yeah? And being hot or being cold, yeah, just a feeling. That's it. But we hate it so much that we always, you know, I mean, our medical supply, especially in the West, is so good that we instantly, you know, when we are in pain, we instantly run to see the doctor. Give me some painkillers, painkillers, painkillers. Yeah? Independent. Yeah? We don't like unpleasant situations. Yeah? So we try to get rid of them. But, you know, in our practice, we just do the opposite. We actually look for unpleasant situations, you know, I mean, in order to be able to deal with them, to learn how to deal with them. Yeah? That's why a monk, you know, it's only once a day, you know, how to learn how to deal with hunger. Yeah? Or he goes out in frightening places, how to learn how to deal with fear. Yeah? That is actually, you know, the incentive, you know, for becoming a monk. We learn how to deal with these things. I mean, somebody is free who is free from fear. Yeah? And free from worries. And free from thought and free from memory. Yeah? That's a person who is free. He's not free of the body because he has a body. So, I mean, he will get hungry, he will get tired, you know, and he will get thirsty. Yeah? He has to take care of the body. Yeah? As long as he has the body. But he's not afraid, you know, being murdered. He is not afraid of being robbed, you know, I mean, he understands it, you know, where it's coming from. That is freedom. Yeah? People always look for the physical freedom, but that is not really freedom. Yeah? I mean, the physical body constantly limits us. Yeah? And what is actually, you know, what is actually driving this body? Yeah? I mean, you will see it. Yeah? You will see it, or you will understand it the moment you go into Apana Samadhi, because there is no more body. The citta has completely gone out of the body. Yeah? The body doesn't exist. Yeah? People can cut you up, you know, while you're in this state. When you come back, you see the body is gone. Then you look for another body. Yeah? It's just like, you know, I mean, you go jogging, you drive with your car to the jogging place, yeah? And while you're jogging, some people smash up your car. They don't smash you up. Yeah? When you go back to the car, you see it's useless, you know, and then you walk back, yeah? Or get a lift. And the body is just a tool for us, yeah. Just like a car is nowadays a tool for us, or the smartphone is a tool for us. Yeah? It's not something, it has no own life. It doesn't have an own life. Yeah? It's actually, you know, very similar to a robot. Yeah? And it's a biological robot. Yeah, it's more complex than any kind of robot that we have built so far. It doesn't have any intelligence. Yeah? I mean, we put all the intelligence in it. Yeah? And the intelligence, when we die, we think it's just gone? No. The intelligence comes from the programmer. Yeah? I mean, anybody who understands a little bit about computer science, I mean, a robot is a machine. Yeah? And if you don't, if you program it rightly, it will do the things that you know you tell it to do. Yeah? And so it's with our body. We learn how to walk when we are born. Yeah? We have to tell the body how to walk. We have to learn it. Yeah? We have to control all these tendons. I mean, it's very fair. It is very, very complex. Yeah? And that's why it takes us so long. One year, 1.5 years. Yeah. The same with speaking, yeah? We learn how to speak, yeah? So we train this robot, yeah? We train this robot for 15 years, yeah? Think about industrial robots, you know, the most complex robots, you know, need only a training of maybe 30 days until it can do its task. But the tasks, of course, are very limited, yeah? So we train this robot for 15 years, yeah? Then we can use it for 30 years where it's working fine, and then it starts to decay. Like anything, like any machine, like any car, you know, it starts to decay until it dies. And then, what does the chitta do? It hops out, or the program, it hops out of the body and looks for another one. So the body is just a tool. And that is what our investigation of the body will reveal. There's nothing to do with us. So get your mind calm, so that there are no more thoughts, no more memories popping up, and then look, yeah, look at this present moment, and then you can ask the chitta the right questions. Yeah? For instance, why I'm in the situation I am in, yeah? And the answer will pop up, but it will not pop up in the form of a thought, yeah? Because when it comes in form of a thought, then it's no good. It's not the right answer. When it comes in form of knowingness, then it's the right answer. And we can distinguish between knowingness and belief that comes in form of thought by doubting that. You cannot doubt knowingness. I mean, somebody who never touched fire, I mean, he can doubt that the fire is hot or the fire is cold or does it burn or doesn't burn. Yeah? But the moment you touch the fire, you know it. And that's exactly what we do in our practice. We know, we learn how to know. Yeah? And that is, of course, you know, completely blurred up by our thoughts and imaginations. Our thoughts and imagination let us live in a virtual reality. Yeah? And the moment we take it on, you know, we become more closer to reality. Yeah? And that's where we know. And the knowingness is that thing, you know, that can change our lives. And the closer we come to this knowingness, the better it is. So get to know yourself. First of all, by leaving out these thoughts, yeah, and memories for a while. You cannot do it forever. In the beginning, you might be able for 1 minute, you know, later on for 5 minutes, and then later on, you know, for an hour, and then 2 hours, 3 hours. Yeah? And that's also our safe place, and that's where we gather concentration. And when we have concentration, then we have some power, we have some energy. Yeah? And when we have some energy, then we can do or start the investigation. Yeah? For instance, start with the body or feeling. Yeah? Shouldn't be a mystery to us. And maybe over time you will understand karma. Karma is that, you know, in short, yeah, what you sow is what you reap. Yeah? But we don't want to reap what we sowed in the past. Nobody wants it. Yeah? We want to reap instantly. Yeah? We do something good, you know, we want to reap it, yeah. We do something bad, we don't want to reap it, yeah? Don't do unto others what you don't want others to do unto you. For everything that happens to you is, yeah, you have done unto others. That's karma. Okay. So, with this I stop the talk. Somebody is very difficult to listen to. Huh?
Sorry.
Huh? You went.
I'm feeling sick.
Mm.
Yeah, it can make one feel sick. Hmm? It can make one feel sick. Okay. So, any questions? I mean, most of the things are probably completely new to you. Yeah. But you know, I mean, we always try to find the truth, but there's the German saying, but we don't like to hear the truth. Yeah. We try to find the truth, but we don't like to see it. You know, we don't like to embrace the truth. So, okay. So that's it for today, yeah? No more questions? Huh? My minds never have any questions? Huh? Okay, well, leave. Yeah.